Thank you very much. You're watching NTV, and we're having a one-on-one interview with the Minister for Education, who is also the First Lady, Honorable Janet Kataha Museveni. Thank you very much for your time, Honorable.
My pleasure.
Let's just talk about your role as the Minister for Education. You were appointed in May last year. It's coming close to a year now. How has it been for you?
It's been challenging. The Ministry of Education is a big ministry. It has many directorates, it has a lot of staff, it has a lot of work. It spreads across the whole country. And it is challenging, to say the least. But it's also interesting, because is something I am passionate about, working and serving my country, for especially with children. And so I poured myself into it, so to speak, and I hope and pray every day that we are making it better, because Uganda needs to see quality education. That's our mission.
Mm-hmm. Some might be curious to find out, what are some of those challenges? You say there's been a lot of challenges. What are some of those that you've met along the way?
Challenges are that I used to see a big budget for the Ministry of Education before I came to the ministry. And I always wondered why that budget couldn't answer all the needs of education in the country. And so I was anxious to find out why we don't get to, for instance, fulfill the policy of the NRM government to provide a UPE primary school per parish, and a USE school for each sub-county in the country. So I came to the ministry, and that was my first stop to learn why don't we do that with the budget we have. Then I had to unpack that budget and try to find out what it is that we do with the money we receive, because it does look big. And when we unpacked it, I learned that a lot of it goes to different places even without coming to the ministry. A lot of the money for universities go directly to universities without coming to the ministry. And the percentage that comes to the ministry is much, much smaller compared to the whole budget. And then that has to also be divided into the many directorates, as I said, of the Ministry of Education. And so what remains at the headquarters of the sector is a very small percentage. And that has to deal with so much that remains in the hands of the headquarters of the sector. And so even that, I needed to find out then what does it do? And it took us a long time to go through it together until we agreed on what was happening and what needs to happen, and so we have to do that every financial year and try to ensure that at least every financial year we do some building of some schools, and slowly we will reduce on the deficit that we have in the country, which is now what we are trying to do. That's one of the many challenges.
Budgeting, that's a very interesting point you hint on, because there's also been a lot, like we said the other day here at the press conference that you had, there's been a lot of concern that government is not allocating enough money to the Ministry of Education, and yet it's a core ministry for this country, especially if we're talking about moving to the middle income status by 2020. You would imagine that you're moving with the population, the literate population, and yet that is not reflected in the budgeting process, especially with how much money is given to the ministry. Are you confident, for instance, about how much you get as a ministry?
I know that what we get is not a bad percentage of our total budget, but certainly our population is increasing all the time, and therefore the needs of the education sector increase all the time. So yes, we would do better if we had more funding in our budget. But I also understand, because the budgeting process go to the whole of government, the cabinet have a sitting to discuss the budget, and therefore I understand why we don't get sufficient funding, because I explained last time why, for instance, we got a cut in our budget this year for the coming financial year. And I appreciate where the money is going, and so we have to allow ourselves to work within our means as a country and as a sector.
Let's talk about performance in general terms, especially UPE schools. There was a report last year in June that was conducted or done by government itself, by the Office of the Prime Minister, which indicated, and if you could just allow me read for you a bit, 34% of teachers don't know English, and 40% are incompetent in primary math. And that was a new government self-assessment report. It further said that half of pupils or children, our children, are not learning and cannot comprehend basic literacy or basic questions for a P3, and if they're in primary six. Are you concerned as a ministry or as a minister for education about those kind of reports or statistics?
Yes, of course, I am concerned. And we are concerned as a sector. And we want to do something about that. We must do something about that, because we are the ones now talking about the quality of education. But I know that that is how it is because of many factors that come with a long history. And I've tried to give some history about education that makes it what it is right now, which does not excuse the fact that we have many weaknesses, but we are working on those weaknesses, and I'm confident that we're getting better every day, and we are trying to retrain our teachers, because the weakness mainly are the teachers. When you have very weak teachers who are not competent themselves, then certainly the learners will not benefit much. So we are trying now to ensure that the training of teachers will bring out a better quality of teachers, so that we can then hope to get a better quality of learners.
That also points to the kind of salary that they get. Many of them are what you would call moonlighting, moving from one school, say, for 5 hours, they go to another school for about 3 hours, they go to another school for maybe another 1 hour to try and make ends meet. And so some would say that the absence or the lack of enough salary for these teachers also affects how they teach.
I don't think that that is the case, because the salaries teachers get in government schools is much better than the salaries get in private schools. And yet private schools teach better than government schools. So the problem of teachers going from government schools to private schools to earn more money is certainly because they would like to earn more. But it's not because they are getting less than what they would get if they were teaching only in private schools. So you can see that there is a contradiction there. Now we think that what we are not doing right is inspection of these schools. Because for private schools, they are more inspected by head teachers and the owners of schools, they do better. Because no teacher working in a private school will leave their school and go elsewhere to teach, while the teachers of in government schools will go elsewhere, and not just one school, but more than one to teach. Yes, and they will get more money, but the problem essentially really is not because they are getting less than the private schools.
The issue of capitation grant. This was a fund that was introduced in 2002 to try and help the UPE pupils, save them from paying school fees. And yet there's still a lot of controversies, a lot of concerns about how this money comes into the schools. Sometimes it comes after the end of the term, which cannot help pupils. What's your comment as a minister?
Yes, I've heard about that complaint. When I hear about that complaint, I go back to a Ministry of Finance, because you understand that capitation grant does not go to, from the Ministry of Finance to Ministry of Education and then to schools. It goes directly from Ministry of Finance to the local government and then to the schools. So I go back to the Ministry of Finance and try to find out why is the grants for schools not getting there in the right time. And they try to tell me, they give me many excuses that I cannot find out at a go, but they give me some reasons.
What are some of those reasons, if you could share with us?
Sometimes they say that they get wrong information from local governments, from district education officers, and so they are late to send capitation grants and so on and so forth. That's why I'm saying that what we're not doing right is inspection of schools, both from the headquarters through our own inspection team, or even the district education officers inspecting schools to be sure that everything is being done the way it ought to be done. So, however, I also have learned that sometimes they collude between district education officers and technical people from the ministries, and they delay the capitation grants because they are investing them elsewhere, and then they will send the money at a later date and things like that, which I cannot prove just yet, but we are working on it.
You sound very optimistic and you give a message of hope about the education ministry. And yet some people would say that these are the same statements that have been said by especially your predecessors. We will work on it, we shall work on it. And yet the education ministry still looks as it does.
Well, I think that's a premature judgment, because I have only had under a year yet. So I think you give me time and we'll see, because time will tell whether what we are saying is what has been told before, or whether perhaps it will bring some results.
You recently made a statement about feeding in schools. You were encouraging parents to do their part and give their pupils or their sons and daughters food. You use the phrase, find some money to buy food flasks for these children, mm-hmm. which was, you know, has been interpreted to mean so many things, that you mm-hmm. were, you did not directly connect with the poor families who may not afford food flasks, and so that you did not really understand the plight of the people that you're talking to.
I think that's very unkind of whoever is saying that, because I came to that after we talked about food and feeding the children at lunch hour, and after we suggested that families pack lunch for their children, some people were demanding that children should have warm lunch. Okay? So I said, now how will they get warm lunch? Because where we are coming from, they are not having any lunch at all. And children are dropping out of school because they don't have food at school at all. So they were saying, well, some people can pay they can pay financially, those who can. Those who can't bring dry ration and it will be cooked at school so that children can have a warm lunch. Now, I said that when we talk about cooking at school, we skip out some of the things that must be said also. Because when you say parents bring dry ration and it's cooked at school, it assumes that there is a cook and there are firewood, there are places to cook, and so food can be prepared for the children to have a warm lunch. But when you bring food, whatever food you bring, dry or fresh, you must also talk about having somebody to prepare that food. And you must buy firewood. And you must have a kitchen. You must have, so there are details we don't tend to talk about. When we have to fulfill all that, it will mean that people will be made to pay some money. And many parents have no money to pay. So I said that the easiest thing to do, which is what government had demanded in the first place, was to pack lunch for each family to pack lunch for their child. I didn't mind what lunch they will pack. But if they demand that their child must have warm lunch, then I said, you can have a food flask and you'll be sure that your child will have a warm lunch. Now, if that is sacrilege, then I apologize. But really, that's what I was trying to say. I had to get to that because of a demand given by some people.
You've been quoted a lot of times in the media and on social media. The other quote that has been attributed to you is the issue of pads, sanitary pads, a promise that was made by President Yoweri Museveni during campaigns. You appeared before a parliamentary committee and you said there was no money for pads as yet. Some would say that this is going back against a promise that your husband or the president made, probably in search for votes or not, but he has not fulfilled. And you're now coming back to the voters or the parliament to say there's no money.
Well, first of all, I want to tell you that some of those members of parliament were actually saying that, first of all, providing sanitary pads to the children is something that cripples the community. That why doesn't families provide pads for their own children? But they said it in a private place. It was not public. And that really didn't have to make me say what I said. But the other day, only the other day, I was explaining to you that the sanitary towels have not been paid for by our budget, because precisely we got a budget cut. And that's how governments work. When you can't fulfill a desire of government, it waits for a following year. And we had request. I told you that the president had not forgotten what he pledged. All of us knew that we were supposed to pay to give the sanitary pad, but the budget could not spread that far, so it had to remain a priority that is not an unfunded priority. And that is not to say that it will not be fulfilled at some at some stage, but right now it isn't.
You've been a champion for girls' rights and girls staying in school. Aren't you concerned as a mother, first of all, how or whether or not a child should stay out of school because they are going through their menstruation period?
I am, but I'm also wondering how else we can do it, because I lead a ministry that can only work through its budget. When we don't have the funding in our budget, our hands are tied. There is no other way we can provide what we need, and so we have to wait.
There have been suggestions made about partnerships, for instance, with some. You have clout as a first lady, first of all, as a minister, that you could get into partnerships, but to try at least and ensure that girls stay in school and not miss classes because of menstruation periods. Have you considered that?
You see, when you talk about sanitary pads that government must provide, we have to provide those sanitary pads when we do across the whole country. You can't say we'll provide them in these schools or in this district and not others. Now, when you have to provide those sanitary pads to all districts in Uganda, you need a reasonable amount of money. And when you start, you can't stop. It has to be an ongoing program that must be done every year. So I cannot think of a partnership I can make that would fulfill that need of government and continue that program throughout the whole time. So I don't like to sound as if this is something I can do just to sound or to be popular. If I say we will do this, it's because I know we can fulfill that. If we can't, I will not go there.
Okay. Lastly, on education, about UPE in general, there have been concerns about how the progress that it has taken over years. They've said, some have said that it's been heavily politicized. What's your take on the general performance of UPE since it was introduced, UPE and USE for that matter?
I know that it could be better, but I told you about the fact that the teachers have not been good teachers, and so I know that we have weaknesses in both UPE and USE. But if we can work on training our teachers and really getting them to be quality teachers, I think we can improve on these schools. But this is because the schools were started in a very short time between UPE and USE. Mm-hmm. There wasn't sufficient time to perfect on one before you get to the other. So it became monumental to do, to be perfect on both in a short time, because the training of teachers, the building of classrooms, the buying of school materials and all that took a lot of funding and in a short time. So it must take time to become perfect. Mm-hmm. And I can understand that people are not patient, neither am I really, I would like to see our education much better than it is, but I know that it isn't. And I know that there are also many things we could do better. But because we have weaknesses among our people, among the teachers, the civil servants, about corruption, about all sorts of things, it takes even more time than it probably would have taken. And we have to work on it. We have to work at that to change it. Talking cannot change that. It takes work, it takes patience, and it takes dedication.
The issue of youth, what's your general take on, I wouldn't want to say the state of our youth, but in general terms, really, as someone who is passionate about, and you say you started an organization, which we all know, the Uganda Youth Forum. So in that lens...
Uganda Youth Forum used to do a lot of work with the youth. And I can tell you, honestly speaking, that it made a big impact when we were working with the youth to bring the reduction of HIV and AIDS, among other things. It wasn't the only one, but it did a big part of it. Because the youth changed their behavior, and they all really lived and abstained, both male and female, abstained from premarital sex, and it just brought HIV and AIDS down like that, you know? And now our youth are lost, so to speak. They are into drugs, they are into homosexuality, they are into all sorts of things, and we are going to have to do that again, the campaign, even through the Ministry of Education, I am hoping. I don't know how much of it we will be able to do, but we will try, because there is a big challenge now with HIV and AIDS going up, and a lot of the infected people are youth. Mm-hmm. And we have teenage pregnancies, and we have all those girls who die in abortions, and all sorts of things.
Mm-hmm. You know, there's been a lot of debate around what our youth are doing, and most people's views seem to suggest that they're doing what they're doing because they don't have jobs, they're unemployed.
You can say that. There is a lot of unemployment, but there is also a possibility that Ugandans today, if they honestly were looking for a way to employ themselves, they would. But the kind of jobs they are looking for are not available, and they don't want to do the kind of jobs that are available. So it makes the employment very difficult. But in the Ministry of Education now, we are doing Skilling Uganda. We are trying to do skills development, which we hope will help both the youth that are getting out of all these universities and those out of school to employ themselves. That's something we are also putting a lot of emphasis on, and I'm hoping that really we'll be able to make some impact with that also.
Mm-hmm. How was it like for you joining politics? The people who probably up to now have never understood why you joined politics.
Yeah, that's a good question. See, when I went into politics, I tried to explain why I went into politics, and people who know me could believe me. People who don't made up their own minds about, oh, come on, she just wants a job or something like that. But honestly, that's not why I went into politics. And I said what I said, it's still true. You may believe it, you may not, but it is true.
there's a lot of talk around you, given your position. A talk around you ever going back into politics, elective politics. Would you consider, or would you give it a thought, especially for the highest office in the land?
Why don't you save that until we get back into that period? We are so far away from there. Let's wait.
Well, we prepare before we get there, so...
I'm not prepared yet.
So you would give it a thought?
I would rather we discuss that at a later date.
By you not commenting about it, you actually are considering it.
I want to tell you something about being obedient to God. It also trains you to speak at the right time when you hear from God, and when you know what God really requires of you at a particular time. You don't assume that you can do anything you want, or you can't do what you want, but you wait on the Lord, and what he tells you, you do when he tells you. And I have trained myself to listen to God. So I try as much as possible to wait on the Lord when what he tells me is what I do. Last time people were surprised that I said I wasn't standing as a member of parliament again, because people don't do that a lot. But I heard from God and I got out of parliament. I'm here also because I'm in service to God. Whether Ugandans believe it or not, that's what I'm doing.
Mm-hmm. We're drawing into another very highly charged political season later, where by 2021, President Museveni will have clocked the required age for, you know, the constitution. As a first lady, how would you advise him to go around that?
That is a very difficult question. I believe that he has a mind of his own, and I think some things have to remain private, no matter how public you are.
Given the nature of your office, the nature of your status as a first lady, there'll be a lot of talk around your family, and there's been a lot of talk around your son, General Muhoozi Kainerugaba, about him being the so-called Muhoozi Project. Have you heard about that?
I've heard about that, but you know, Muhoozi is also an adult, and I wish you could talk to him directly, because he lives right here. You can talk to him yourself.
But I'm talking to you as a mother. Would you...
But you see, a mother speaks for a son until he's probably 15 years old. After that, that's a man. And a mother doesn't talk for a man.
At least you advise him. Would you advise him to join elective politics? Especially seeing that you've been there yourself.
I don't think I want to go there.
Okay.
I think you have to agree that really our family has been misunderstood for many things. Mm-hmm. Our family is a family just like yours. And I believe that we have served this country with dedication, with sincerity. We've made lots of sacrifices, and we are people who don't just think about ourselves first. And it's painful when you see what people can decide to say. But we do our best, and we pray that God does the best. I mean the rest. Mm-hmm. He does the rest, and people who understand us do. Those who don't, no matter how we explain, will not understand us. So trying to explain and to labor to explain sometimes doesn't really help. So we do what we can, we say what we ought to say, and we let it stop there.
You know, over time, you and your husband, President Yoweri Museveni, have gained a lot of supporters, but you've also gained a lot of critics. What would you say to the critics of you and President Yoweri Museveni, especially to him about his stay in power? Some would say that he has overstayed in power, and it's perhaps time that he considers leaving.
Honestly, because what do you want me to say? You know, when you are in politics, you are, first of all, I want to tell you that I never used to think I would find myself in politics. I even used to say, God is wise, he couldn't possibly send me into politics. Because I believed I was not really cut out for politics. Here I am. And so the fact that I'm here makes my explanation very difficult, because I'm here. I'm in politics. And if I could have my way, I wouldn't be. Believe me.
Do you regret joining politics?
I don't regret, because I know I am there in service to God. And I can't disobey God, no matter what it costs me with the people, because I fear God and my life depends on him.
What has been the most difficult part of your life?
The most difficult part was the part I had to live with my children without my husband. I was a young mother, and I had a very young family, and I had to leave my homeland unwillingly, but I had to leave because now I had the choice to stay and maybe die or lose the children or whatever. And so I left not knowing where in the world I was going. I think that was the most difficult part of my life.
What would you want to be remembered for, your legacy?
Maybe, I hope, the mother I was to my children, and to those who trusted me as a mother, because there are many who are not my biological children, but who became my children.
First Lady Janet Kataha Museveni, I thank you.